Hello, everybody. Again, sad to say we couldn't be there in person, particularly given the theme of interdependence. It's quite funny to discuss some of this stuff, obviously, in relation to the situation with COVID, and maybe to preempt some thoughts about how this thesis correlates with the present situation we're in. You know, pretty much my position on it is that as much as this is kind of an unexpected and unprecedented time, in many ways, I think that the situation we find ourselves in with COVID can almost be best seen as kind of a dress rehearsal for things that were going to happen anyway, sadly. So, you know, particularly when later I start talking about issues or policy related to climate, you know, the sad expectation that border policy, et cetera, you know, may well indeed end up becoming more conservative and punitive over time. A lot of the things that I've been thinking about in relation to interdependence were very much in anticipation of that, of thinking, well, you know, what does it mean when we can anticipate perhaps in the next 20 to 30 years the global political and economic situation changing significantly, whether that relate to a lot of the stuff that we talked about earlier with machine learning and the new stack of tools, or related to, you know, quite, I think we'd all agree, reprehensible political developments of the past couple of years. And, you know, so even though this talk doesn't explicitly reference the situation related to COVID, I think that it if anything, COVID has just kind of accelerated the urgency for us to think of different models. You know, because the one thing COVID has done, in a sense, is it's a brutal photographer, right? Like, it's taking a very brutal picture of what foundations we can depend on in time of need, and what foundations really only work when everything is tuned perfectly, right? And so a lot of my criticism, for example, of what I would describe as like the app economy, right? The iPhone is 12 years old now. It's kind of crazy to think that the iPhone is only 12 years old. But this kind of app economy of you and your mobile phone against the world with your SoundCloud account and your Ableton on your laptop, we've seen this economy kind of ride by on very, very fine margins for the past 10 years. And I think that COVID, it's another opportunity to reflect on, you know, some of the failures of that, and maybe have some bigger ideas or more ambitious ideas for what we can look forward to. The other thing I was going to say is, as with the talks earlier, I know it's more difficult, obviously, with us being remote, but in case anything comes up and you want to talk in the middle of the presentation, let's do that, because in actuality, I think as much as I can talk forever, you know, the real opportunity of us sharing this time and virtual space together, at least, is, you know, to be able to discuss things. And so if there's anything specifically related to the situation over in Prague that comes up, then I'm more happy to talk about that than I am to, you know, knock you over the head with all these weird references I'm going to give you. So really, really happy. Really, really happy to join you. I'm going to share a screen now. And I think protocol, in case anyone joined, protocol earlier for that was, if you have anything to say, just put your hand up and there's microphones in the room, and I'll keep an eye out, or just feel free to interrupt me. Okay, so I'm going to share a screen. One second. Would you mind enabling the screen sharing? Sorry, we did it earlier, but I think we're in a new session now, and so it needs to be enabled.
I have to do.
Yeah, there's a there's basically I forget where it is, but there's some kind of option for you to allow me to share my screen.
Just a moment, please.
Yeah, sorry. This is Michal. I'm back. I know how I did it the first time.
Hey, don't worry.
It should work now.
Mm-hmm. Perfect. Thank you. Thank you. Okay, can you all see that?
Yes.
Awesome. Okay. Yeah, so this correlates a lot, I think, with some of the stuff that Holly and I together and Holly separately discussed earlier. But basically, when we've been thinking about all the work that we've been doing with machine learning, and in tandem the research that I've been doing on kind of economic systems, is based around what we would frame as an interdependent music. And I'm gonna qualify that more. Basically, I'm gonna start out by presenting a bit of a critique of the notion of independence, this idea that was very, very successfully proliferated during the 20th century as kind of like a liberation, and I would argue has kind of run its course. I would argue has been taken to an extreme, and present this maybe counter narrative, which is to say, an interdependent music or a state of interdependence is actually the optimum goal. The goal is not, as this meme kind of jokes, the goal is not for us all to be each isolated, right? Like So as the meme goes, as usual, we often mistake isolation for independence. And I would argue, that ultimately true independence actually comes through interdependent systems, right? When you feel like someone has your back, when you feel that you can make free creative decisions because you're not totally alone having to market yourself online or have the right opinions in certain contexts or whatever it might be, that's actually true independence. Independence as isolation is actually not very free at all. And I'm going to explain why, at least from my perception. So ultimately, independence as a term, familiar to most people in music, it doesn't really tell you very much anymore. The argument being, in a sense, that at one point, independence was presented as a necessary development or rebellion against very conservative kind of institutional systems. And yet now, kind of inarguably, independence is the kind of the goal of, the largest economic systems in the world. This idea of individuating us both as producers or creators and as audience members, right? And you can tell this by the business models of, let's say, an Uber or a Deliveroo, right? Even though having these apps on your phone allows you or affords you the ability to determine your own work schedule, I think after maybe 10 years of having these services in place, we also see the bad side of that, right? We see the side that you also don't have any security or protection over the work that you do. You don't have any ability to collectively bargain as you once would have done, maybe as a factory worker or a unionized worker in an established field, right? And kind of the same with music. Even though, and I'll talk about this a lot, like the legacy of kind of independent music initially was this idea of saying we need an ability for people who are not necessarily invited into conservative, often very racist, sexist institutions, let's say in the 1950s. We've now kind of taken that independence idea to such an extent that the main gospel from industry, really, and you see this with a Spotify quite significantly, is you are an isolated individual, and all tools are developed in a sense to allow for you alone to try and navigate this very tricky and confusing online and real world ecosystem. And so in a sense, whereas independence began as this idea of wanting to rebel against conservative institutions, now in a sense, if you wanted to rebel against a conservative institution, the conservative institution you would rebel against is the idea of independence and isolation, is the idea of you as an isolated economic actor in the world. This is actually the conservative institution that we face in the 21st century. And so To give a bit of a context too, also, you know, for I assume that most people in the room are here from a musical context. I was looking at some of the presentations that happened earlier, and a lot, it's pretty much mostly in a musical field. I also would argue that independence, in a sense, as we understand it from the 21st century, the 20th century. So you have ideas, for example, inherited from punk movements, hardcore movements, indie movements, hip hop movements, techno movements. In a sense, the precedents established by those models in the 20th century are an impossible legacy to upkeep, right? Because one, the world's just a completely different place. The economic systems we live under, the political systems we live under, the technical systems we interact with are entirely different. But number two, you know, anyway, I'm going to qualify that a little bit. So independence in the present day, right? Like, now cities are very expensive. There's a great moment in Adam Curtis, one of the Adam Curtis films, I forget which one, where they show Patti Smith, you know, kind of living this bohemian life in the center of Manhattan in New York, right? And there was a period of time from the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, where living in inner cities, living a kind of bohemian life was actually very accessible. Cities were more dangerous, and they were cheap. And so this idea of like moving to a major city and having all this free time to establish a creative practice, et cetera, is kind of a mythology. It doesn't really exist anymore, right? And it's also very, very hard, this idea of DIY that was kind of a big idea that happened in the 20th century. It's very hard to follow when there are so few spaces to play, right? Cities, and I'm sure this is the same in Prague as it is in Berlin, as it is in London, as it is in New York. You know, the space has become this scarce thing. It's almost impossible in some senses, outside of cool spaces like the one you're in right now, to be able to establish a foothold on a city. And this is one of the reasons why a lot of activity has largely moved online, which I personally see, I'm not against it, but I see as like, it's not quite the same, let's say. The other thing you can say is that, you know, when we think of independent music of the 20th century, we think of like hard principles, right? So a classic example would be Fugazi, the classic hardcore punk band, you know, refusing the ability for Nike to use their image in advertising, right? Like Nirvana, Kurt Cobain decrying the influence of brands in the world, right? Like, which I still think, to be quite honest, is quite cool, even though that the consensus on that has significantly shifted in my lifetime. But the point being is that it's very hard to stick to these kind of puritanical principles when nobody's making any money, right? When the creative economy has changed as such that we no longer have the financial security to be able to say no to things, right? The sad truth is that Fugazi and Nirvana and, you know, underground resistance or whatever could take these stances because they were making money. They were selling a lot of records. In some cases, you know, millions of records, right? And those records were producing a lot of cash for them. So this idea that, for example, I would judge someone now for taking money from a brand, it's a very, very different proposition than it might have been in the 1980s. And so it seems a bit silly to kind of inherit this ideology from a different time, right? Also, you could argue that few kind of DIY, do-it-yourself alternatives can compete in the online attention economy, right? So one of the mythologies of online is this idea that everybody can find your work online, right? So you as an independent creator technically can post something to YouTube, and technically, hypothetically, a bunch of people could find it. But realistically, do they, right? And in actuality, the numbers on this demonstrate that increasingly they don't, right? So for example, I mean, a case comes to mind. There was a study done recently that learned that the top 1% of artists earn 90% of the streams on Spotify, which works out to be that, you know, around about 16,000 people globally make any kind of real money from Spotify, which is actually significantly less than the traditional recording industry in the 1980s, which is a staggering kind of statistic, but also demonstrates in a sense that this mythology that having access to all these tools to publish whatever is creating this abundance of opportunity is, it's like one of these hypotheticals. It's technically kind of true that you have the opportunity, but in reality, actually what happens is that a greater concentration emerges at the top than even before, even with the imperfect systems that we had before. Similarly, we're all independently free to post our ideas online, but we're not equally capable of profiting from them, right? And I'm going to talk a little bit about this later. And as a result, just as Facebook can buy and does buy any small-time competitor, major pop franchises can hoover up ideas from the margins before you have the ability to build any wealth and status, right? So when we're all these individuated, kind of isolated economic creators online, being encouraged to freely share what we do with no real guarantees of economic security from that or any kind of compensation from that, it is a field day for the minority at the top, right? So, and this is, I've had this validated multiple times. I'll speak to people at major labels who, you know, the cost of A&R has, so A&R, for those who don't know, like artist relations, basically like scouting, seeing who they want to represent or invest in, their costs have dropped significantly because everybody just posts stuff online and they just like study the numbers. You know, and so ultimately, I would flip this notion that having all this access in a sense gives opportunity to little guy. In actuality, I think it's the other extreme. I think the other extreme is everybody's free to post online, but in actuality, the people who tend to benefit from that are the big fish, because they can basically just take their pick of any idea and kind of rinse it oftentimes. And you see this in classic examples. It's like, you know, for those of you familiar with like niche musical subcultures, right? These things come and go within a matter of weeks. You know, the speed of adoption of a, you know, C-punk, witch house, hyper-pop, whatever the fuck you want to call it. These things will start on a small level, gain a little bit of traction, and then already be represented by the biggest pop stars by the end of the month. And at which point, those ideas are kind of exhausted by the time that any of the originators might have to do something with it or make a living from it. You know, it's, yeah. And so, as a result, and I mean, Holly and I joke about this sometimes, and it's not, it's a bittersweet kind of melancholy joke, but ultimately, in the case of like the capital M music economy, the big music economy, in a sense, we've conceded that our role in the new economy is basically market testing for bigger artists. that, you know, we make our research and the stuff we do and the decisions that we make basically experiments with options for other people to do at lower risk later, which to me is actually a far more accurate reflection of the contemporary music economy than you know, than the kind of marketing language around streaming platforms, right? Like, we take risks at less cost than pop stars, and the ones that work, pop stars will adopt once they've seen that it works on a smaller level. You could also argue as a critique, right, that music that thrives on streaming platforms best suits the needs of those streaming platforms, right? Like, as the journalist Liz Pelly coined the term Spotify core, everybody in the room, even though we might have different definitions of it, we kind of intuitively know what kind of music I'm talking about, right? It's like there's particular stylistic attributes, there's particular characteristics that allow for music to thrive on streaming, just as there's particular characteristics that allow for artists to thrive on Instagram. Like, there's a certain photogenicness or whatever that allows for certain artists to thrive on Instagram. And so an easy contestation there would be, you know, can that really be described as independence, or have we replaced an ecosystem of gatekeepers, right, the major labels, the independent labels, with a couple of gatekeepers, right, Instagram, Spotify, you know, yeah, I think to be honest, it's inarguable that we have similarly, you have a good case in point here would be like an artist like Chance the Rapper, who those of you who may be familiar is often fated as kind of an icon of independent music, as he releases by himself. He's self-released and he plays stadiums. He's a rather large artist. But when you look at it from this angle of saying, well, no, well, basically Spotify and these streaming platforms are basically just the new major label, the new institutions, it would be almost impossible for somebody to reach that level without the being held in good favor by those services. It's just kind of impossible. And so the question or the provocation that I'm going to speak to a bit later is saying, well, with all this stuff in mind, you know, what is a dignified model for a future of music that we would like to see? And who determined that streaming is that future? I certainly don't see streaming as that future. I think, if anything, streaming is a concept that ought to be rejected happily. And of course, maybe the one conceptual foundation from streaming that is the best thing to reject first is this idea that any one person has the solution for the future of music, right? Because just as I might have some cool things to share with you, I don't have a clue what music scenes in Prague could do or what would benefit music scenes in Prague because I don't live there. And I think that even though there are certain universal principles that can be applied that I'll speak to, one of the first kind of conceptual abstractions that I think needs to be made is this idea of no one size fits all solutions. You know, me being a somewhat technocratic person in Berlin should not be designing the way that your scene works. I can help, perhaps, but yeah. So when Daniel Ek and Spotify, for example, propose that they can solve music for everybody, the absurdity of this needs to be challenged, right? And I think that's honestly common sense, but it's, yeah, the world hasn't caught up to that yet, sadly. And to give credit also to the legacy of 20th century kind of subcultures and independent music, the one inspiration that we can take from that is that they kind of did this before. That even though I might criticize these institutions, these are the institutions that basically set the course of my life. I have a great amount of respect and kind of I cherish them greatly. And just as the original indies created their own alternative ecosystems relevant to their desires and needs, we need to do the same as them. And this is something that comes up quite a lot, and I think maybe would have come up in Holly's talk earlier. You know, the most respectful thing that you could do to the godfathers, godmothers of independent music, or to the godfathers, godmothers of the avant-garde, is to do what they did. And what they did was say, I'm not going to be burdened by the last 50 years, and I'm going to try and make something new that meets my contemporary conditions. And so, you know, the best thing you can do to respect Stockhausen is do as Stockhausen did, which is reject people who, you know, were alive 50 years ago, or for the most part. So before I get started, because that was kind of like my intro, and I'm going to go a little bit deeper now on fun stuff with videos, does anyone have any questions in the short term? I want to try and break it up a little bit so I'm not just talking, because I can talk forever, you know?
Yeah. Hi, this is Michal again. I have a question, maybe you will address it later, so just stop me, but how does COVID fit into the picture? Because I think it's like a major game changer, at least short term. One of the things where it changes a lot is that suddenly there's no like the run for the money is gone, because like no one's making any money, and that's not even the big players. I mean, like Spotify, yes, Instagram, yes, but like even the, you know, like the live industry, live music industry is gone pretty much for this year, maybe for next year. So this might, you know, change things, you know, and take us back to grassroots maybe. So what are your thoughts on that? Or maybe you will talk about this later, I don't know.
I will a little bit, but it's worth just checking in on that point, because it's the elephant in the room, right? Like, the first thing I would say, which I was kind of alluding to earlier a little bit, is just, I think COVID just accelerates the urgency. I don't think that, of course, in the short term, it changes a lot when you can't congregate in real space, and you can't have live music economy in the short term. But I reject the catastrophism of saying, oh, well, all concerts are going to be online in future. I think this is just utter bullshit, right? It might take a year, it might take 2 years, it might take 5 years. We don't know, and I can't say. But the future of music is material. The future of music is people sweating in space, period. And that actually, that is the one value proposition music has over every other entertainment medium, right? And so in actuality, a lot of kind of like online performances, I've actually been kind of a skeptic. Later, I'm going to talk a little bit about some potential, I think, for embracing grassroots and embracing what would be described as like telematic performance, this idea of being able to connect spaces that are geographically remote from each other. I think that's very interesting, actually. But outright, I've actually online pretty much been like a bit of a dickhead about online performances, because for me, I think one of the fundamentals of music is understanding where the true value lies. Actually, the real value of music is not in sharing files, right? I think the verdict is in on that, right? Like, we're not, as much as Bandcamp, I appreciate that people post stuff to Bandcamp, and look, it's a weird time, and I don't judge anybody for doing what they need to do to get by and get through this. But I've taken to referring to Bandcamp as like Band-Aid. You know, it's this kind of short-term idea that long-term I just don't see has legs. Long-term, I see the future being all about meeting and connection and an in-person space, which is kind of crazy to say during COVID, but exactly as you said, like, I think the grassroots is going to start becoming significantly important. And actually, there's a lot of great possibilities that come from that, right? And I say this as someone who's benefited from transnational festival networks, et cetera, but I also have, you know, the majority of my friends have not benefited from that and actually find it quite conservative and boring that, you know, there's a small elite of artists that get to travel around the world all the time. And then, you know, local scenes actually in some ways suffer from it. I bring up an example where we went to play a show in Finland actually, and we're asking friends there like, oh, you know, who should we invite to play with us? And they were like, yeah, we don't know. People don't play music. Like, people don't play music anymore. They just go and see Americans and English people play music. You know, and I was like, that's fucked up. I mean, and I've heard similar stories in Mexico, you know, and I won't speak to Prague, but the point being is that re-embracing actually a diversity of musics from different locations, dealing with different shit, is, I think, actually kind of a positive that will actually complexify and make music more interesting. But a lot of the stuff that I'll speak to is, in a sense, it's kind of like COVID adjacent. There's nothing specifically in there, but the reason for that for me is that I just think beyond the short term nuisance and agony in some cases of not being able to gather in space, the problems kind of remain the same. It's just, in a way, kind of, if there's one positive that comes from all of this, it's just made really clear that something needs to be done, you know. And as someone who, you know, has been kind of shouting from the rooftops for years now that this, what we had, was unsustainable, I'm not enjoying the bad news. But that being said, COVID has just made it really freaking clear that, like, if we don't think of different ways to organize ourselves, a lot of what we love will disappear. And sadly, we're seeing that in real time, right? With a lot of venues closing, et cetera. And it's like, they would, yeah. So I hope that speaks to your question a little bit. I definitely have a lot of stuff coming up that does talk a little bit more about structures that I think are very relevant to the COVID situation. But yeah, I agree with your gut feeling that actually embracing the people around you is was always a good idea, and maybe COVID has just made that more vivid. Do we have any more questions before I run on?
Okay, thank you. Anyone more? Yeah.
Hey, I just wanted to, maybe you're going to talk a bit more. Hey, good to see you. A bit more about the streaming, because you just mentioned that you think streaming is not the future. I personally can't really imagine a lot of will in the general population to go away from such a really easy way to access music. I can, because I'm a designer myself, I can really imagine like Spotify being out-innovated by a bit more sustainable model of redistributing the profits. Maybe if you have something to say to that, maybe you're gonna mention it further in the talk, but thanks.
No, it's a good question. I do like beat up Spotify a bit more in this presentation, but it's good to speak to that. So my basic position on Spotify is there's two sides to it, right? The one side, I agree with you. I think that the verdict is in many senses that, you know, whether it be Spotify or Amazon or, you know, any company that eventually acquires them, I don't see it going away at all. And actually, the main reason for that is it works really, really well, actually, for the majority of people. And that's both artists and audiences included, right? So the 1% of artists that take up 90% of the streams, who tend to be the artists with the most influence in many cases, it works well for them. It's replaced the sales economy, and it's produced some kind of a stimulus to them, particularly the major labels who are shareholders and basically have a monopoly over their playlist system and their front page. It also works really, really well for kind of the stragglers, right? Like the maybe 80 to 90% of musicians in the world who have no community, and all they want to do is make a track from a tutorial on YouTube and publish it somewhere. You know, and when I speak about interdependent music and the opportunities available to us, I'm just kind of assuming that everybody in this room doesn't fall in either of those categories. I don't, right? I am not one part of the 1%. I can guarantee you that. We make no money from Spotify when it comes to streaming. I'm also not part of the 80 to 90% of people who just casually make music and want a place to post it in the hope that the ambient playlist picks it up, right? What I believe, and I hope I'm not speaking for out of turn here, but what I believe we represent is a massive minority. And the massive minority is maybe the 5 to 10% of people who pursue music for more than what I just described. They pursue music for more than the prospect of creating a hit, right? I've met people who, very famous pop musicians, who are, you know, they're kind of like bedroom, it's almost like they're in their 50s and they have a studio in the back where they like to jam on guitar. They don't come from a community at all. They just, you know, kind of got fortunate. And that isn't really what music means to me. Music is, you know, it's a means to meet people. It's a means to build big, bold ideas that have influence far beyond our number, right? It's music that communicates with an archive. It's music that has a sense of identity and a sense of competing identities, right? It's a discourse. and so while I don't see streaming going away, my argument in a sense is if you fall into that large minority, that large 5 to 10%, I don't think that arguing over pennies on streaming is the best or most interesting or most inspiring challenge. And I've had this conversation, for example, you know, I've been very involved in this past number of years. There's a number of kind of like music worker alliance unions starting, attempting to represent musicians' rights to streaming platforms, etc. All of this, I think, is positive generally to communicate a sense of solidarity or a sense of like, we need to make something happen. But I say the same thing to them as I say to you, which is, you know, this large minority has opportunities available to it that all those other musicians don't have. Most pop musicians don't come from a scene. They don't come from a community. They're maybe very attractive or very talented in kind of classical ways when they're 17 and they get picked up on some development deal. Or, you know, they're just musicians in their bedroom in the middle of nowhere who like don't have any great aspirations, don't care about the history of music, don't care about the legacy of subcultures, and they just do it for fun or whatever. We're not them. And in actuality, these ideas of, say, redistributive ideas within streaming, Spotify's not going to do that. The one respect I give to Spotify, they're really fucking smart. You know, the people, the algorithm and the per stream payout on Spotify has been meticulously tweaked to be able to create the service that they have created. And so the argument, in a sense, is in giving respect to what they do, you also have to understand that they're not going to change that model for the benefit of the 5% of people for whom that model does not work. If it works for the other 95%, does that make sense?
Yeah, that makes sense. I kind of just like wanted to react on something a little bit different. If you think in this sort of like neoliberal capitalist competition, if it's possible that Spotify is out innovated on, let's say, a bit more ethical terms of redistributing the wealth, let's say Bandcamp out innovates Spotify, like creates equally good user experience for the listeners, which I have to say right now with Bandcamp is like really horrible. But they have a different distribution model. And if you think that is even possible, like in today's world, that it gets out-innovated and people under the pressure of the artists actually transition. Because we've seen a little bit of that with Tidal. At least there was this like massive like press conference when they launched it, and it was all about that.
Yep. Yes, but I don't think it's going to come from a kind of like warehouse of music concept like a Bandcamp or a Tidal. And so one of the things I'm going to go into is talking more specifically about kind of Web3 protocols or new concepts that maybe move past the Web2 experience of the platform into ideas of distributing equity to users. I think that, you know, ethics is one of these things that like is really hairy, right? Because again, the people who largely make the arguments that, you know, we need to get artists paid more, etc., they fall in this 5 to 7% minority that we're talking about. They fall in these kind of circles that we occupy. There's an ethical argument, the ethical counter argument that is always made, and Daniel Ek makes this himself, is the idea of accessibility, right? So whereas we might come across, and I largely agree with certain principles that say, you know, we really ought to pay for some aspects of music, whether or not we pay for the files or whether we support artists through Patreon, through subscription services, whatever it might be. I'm definitely amenable to that idea. I think genuinely you need to pay for culture if you want it to exist. But the counter argument to that is every one of us that says that, there's gonna be 20 people that say, well, you're gatekeeping, you know, what about, you know, we live now in a time of abundant music in which nobody has to pay for anything. And to be honest, there's more of them than there are of us. So even within kind of the streaming context, I don't think that argument is gonna work. You know, this kind of idea of like ethical fair trade capitalism, whatever, you know, there will be a small minority. And I think that with Bandcamp, we're already kind of seeing that. And it's largely amongst kind of older people, right? Like people who were vinyl collectors, and then you have Instagram accounts where you play like a Brian Eno record, and then you talk about the new Bandcamp thing you bought on Bandcamp Friday. But this is like a tiny, tiny, tiny minority of people.
Yeah, sure. But with other apps like Uber or maybe Airbnb, that we've seen already a lot of backlash in the public domain, maybe because they, you know, influence our lives a lot more. But we've certainly seen like some collective like change in behavior based on, let's say, some sexual harassment in Uber and so on. So we've seen that something can happen, and it might like impact the apps.
It could, and I think that, I mean, all I will say on that is that generally speaking, the changes that we see occurring tend to not affect people's bottom line, right? They tend to not be making material demands on the platforms. You know, and so now again, I mean, one of the challenges now with a lot of these Web2 platforms is that they've already subsumed kind of a lot of this critique, right? It's like, we are now, you know, Spotify will post adverts that they're all about diversity. They're all about all these things that are basically cheap for them to do. I think it gets very difficult when you start talking about material demands of changing the business logic behind what these companies do. And where I agree with you, at least, is I think there are great opportunities to outcompete them. However, as I'll explain later, and I do go into this quite a lot, if you're going to compete, we need to compete by doing what they cannot do. And I think that's the important equation here. I don't think that And I've worked on one of these. I worked on a basically a platform co-op streaming system for a couple of years. I volunteered literally 2 years of my time to it. And the conclusion I came to is that that argument is not sufficient. It's cool. You can, you know, the press will write about it. The Guardian will every 6 months release a new article about how fair trade streaming or blah, blah, blah is going to change the world, but people don't adopt it. I think that if you actually want to directly compete with these services, you have to analyze carefully what they do and do what they cannot. And I think that the main principle, one of the things I'll talk about later, which relates to interdependence, I think is really this idea of equity. I think that when you start talking about concepts like an ownership economy, of the ability to, you know, grow wealth together in a way that is transparent, new economic relationships between communities of people and artists, for example, that we're beginning to see emerge, I think that those will be the killers. Those will be the ones that will start moving people and migrating people away from Spotify. And ultimately, my hope at least, is that Spotify and these streaming services end up being roughly what commercial radio is or was, right? Like that there are these things that just kind of work for most people kind of in the background, but if you're really, really serious about culture and if you, there are other dimensions to culture that you want to support, there are all kind of more interesting interactions that you can have that provide more meaningful experiences for you, right? Like, and then, yeah. So I'll talk about that a little bit. I'm completely in your camp in a sense. I think that these things need to be competed.
I think you really answered my question now. Thanks so much.
Easy. Well, hopefully I'm going to answer it more.
Yes. Amazing. I can't wait. Let's move on.
All right. So it's really cool to be able to smoke while we do this. By the way, it's kind of the one benefit to the one benefit to these kind of remote presentations. Okay. So let me do a quick time check. Okay. So I'm actually gonna run along a little bit more because I have like so much here related to kind of shitting on independence, and because of the nature of the conversation, I just think I have too many slides to be honest. So I'm gonna skip past these. But basically, here we have an example of you might recognize the song. Wait, so the reason I bring that up is, you know, in the 90s, for those of you old enough to remember, I was a teenager at the time, this idea of like the new web, putting tools in people's hands to control the world around them, the idea of remixing and sample culture was very, very hip at the time, DJing and hip hop culture, was represented this kind of ability for us to break free from conservative institutions. And I think it represented that with some credibility. I think it's really funny, though, that 20 years on, to celebrate the release of that song, they re-recorded the song and made a new version and a new video for, I believe, a Belgian data collection telecommunications company, in which, you know, the original video, which was this cute kid, like, using, a mini disc player to remix the world around him, has turned into this girl who... It looks a little bit like the kid with the dreadlocks, but as you'll see in the video, I think it takes on a more sinister tone given what we know has happened over the last 20 years. Have there is, you know, we go from this kind of cute period where the individual empowered with their digital devices gets to like play funny tricks on the train into a kind of like sociopathic individual with their devices throwing people downstairs with their iPhone, which I think is maybe presents a kind of souring of that original vision. And it, when I saw that happen, it brought to mind this kind of classic example from the Twilight Zone that I'll play for a second just because it's fun. Wait.
You're a bad man. You're a very bad man. And you keep thinking bad thoughts about me.
Oh! So the point being there is, so in that classic Twilight episode, you have this kind of like sociopathic child that has the power to kind of to turn somebody into a jack in the box if they disagree with their statements. And in a sense, this kind of idea of us as these kind of ruthless individuals that see the world as a terrain that we can conquer ourselves is kind of a sociopathic desire, right? And to qualify this a little bit, I would argue that in a sense, the independence economy, even though it kind of, the way in which it's been designed and the way in which we've been incentivized to move within it, has in a sense kind of systematized lying, dishonesty, scam attitudes, right? Like, and I'll qualify this a little bit further. So ultimately, like, individualist protocols are vulnerable to mistruth. I sadly won't get to talk about this too much. I'm sure the gentleman designer who just threw me a question, it won't be lost on him to talk about how HTML, so the protocol that won the web, right, the hypertext markup language, basically allowed for us, in this kind of spirit of individualist independence, allowed for us to kind of fabricate and curate our own reality. And it did this by basically breaking hard attribution links online, right? So when you make a web page, you're free to put whatever you want on that page. And let's say you put a video of a song on there, that song doesn't link back to the person who made it. Everything is about you and your desires and what you want to put online. And this was kind of the principle that ended up winning the web. And as I'll talk about a little bit later, it didn't necessarily need to be that way. But it very much falls into this kind of independence mythos. Similarly, the idea and this kind of decision that was made in Web 2 that the dominant economic kind of system on the web was going to be advertising, right? And what is advertising? Advertising is professional lying, right? I mean, it's manipulation. We didn't determine, but the people who invested money in these things determined that the model that was going to fund the web was basically the manipulation of people. And I don't need to talk too much about how that has serious political ramifications. There's enough of that in the news right now. But similarly, part of the doctrine of you as an independent musician, and this is, we'll start to see this when Spotify rolls out its two-sided marketplace, is this idea that you, with your device and your Ableton, can produce everything yourself, and then you're going to be able to basically invest in advertising in order to get people to listen to your work, right? So already that advertising logic of the web is being refined down into a strategy for people to succeed online. And that's not lost on you. It's not lost on anybody who uses the internet. But again, it didn't necessarily need to be that way. But I think the spirit of independence at the time was lubricated by this idea of an advertising economy. And then the other one that I mentioned earlier is basically the fallacy that one solution can solve problems for everybody globally. I think that, you know, that and you mentioned Airbnb earlier. I'm not sure how that has impacted Prague, but there's numerous European cities that have ostensibly been devastated by the Airbnb economy. So this idea that someone who actually hung out with one time and asked him about this, that one or two guys in California having a bright idea about people sleeping on couches is going to be a perfect fit for everywhere in the world is just fabricated. It's bullshit, and it needs to be opposed. Similarly, in terms of the spirit of independence, this is kind of like a principle. So Admiral Grace Hopper is often credited as being one of the first hackers. I mean, she's incredibly accomplished. A computing pioneer, as it's described here, came up with this principle where her principle was, it's easier to ask forgiveness than it is to get permission, right? So again, when we think about, let's say, the sampling economy or the remixing economy of the 20th century, the idea is that ultimately the individual should be free to do what they want and ask forgiveness later, right? And I think, again, that kind of spirit of, you know, move fast, break stuff, fast iteration, all this kind of bullshit of the independence economy of the 20th century that bled into Web 2, that starts becoming really sinister when you start talking about, as you say, like Airbnb forcing everyone in their 20s in Lisbon to live with their parents, right? It would be really cool if they might have asked permission before that was deployed. So In a nutshell here, if you were to break down kind of independence or interdependence as opposing protocols or original sins or ideas to be explored further, you have these kind of contrasts, right, between HTML, as I just described, and something more close to the vision of Ted Nelson, that Ted Nelson had for the web, where basically the web would work kind of like a library system, where if you put something on your page, there would be always a hard-coded link back to the creator of that thing, right? Which now makes so much sense, and actually so much money is being spent to try and like make a new web that kind of works like that. But he was arguing for that, you know, at the time, like right at the birth of the web. And similarly, these other ideas that I'm about to try and unpack a little bit from the 20th century that I think do need revision. The sampling alibi, right? This idea that every individual ought to just have the tools to just take what they want and then maybe ask forgiveness later, versus the very basic interdependent principle of accreditation and remuneration. Of, you know, crediting people who contributed to your artwork or to your project, and hopefully paying them if you have the means to be able to do that. You could say that the DJing alibi, as I'll speak to a bit later, is quite similar, and ultimately this boils down to a dichotomy between individual rights and collective rights. I'm going to move past this part, even though it's really fun, because I'm just really considerate of time. But basically, you know, I think there's all kind of signs that we've moved into kind of a scam economy, that independence when taken, the fragile kind of ideology of independence when taken to its logical conclusion ultimately leads to scamming. And I think my, you know, in contrast to, for example, Cybertron's, you know, if you listen to many of the early pioneers of Detroit techno, they imagine you know, Detroit as kind of this place for speculations on a bountiful future. Instead, contemporary Detroit, and I actually love this artist. I'm not sure who here is familiar with TJX6. I think he's absolutely remarkable, not least because he gives me some qualification for my arguments. But we move into this kind of territory where contemporary Detroit is basically, you have this young artist, MC, literally rapping tutorials on how to scam people. And I think his music's really, really cool, but that's his whole thing. It's a genre called scam rap, in which he basically explains to people how to get credit card numbers off people, how to, you know, convert that stuff into Bitcoin so that it's not traceable. Really, really fascinating, and I believe very, very contemporary artist. I also think the music sounds kind of good. I'll play some now. But he literally started doing this because he wanted to sell tutorials of how to scam people, and he found that the tutorials would go further if he put them to a hip-hop beat. I mean, it's just remarkable and pragmatic. I love it. But yeah, here's a short excerpt from one of his videos that I think is, yeah, probably my favorite thing I saw last year. Break my cousin off a couple hundred cause she play her part. I scammed the same Walmart 50 times, I gotta play it smart. Listen to what I gotta say, I'm about to get. I'm playing crazy like I'm shopping here for clothes, then hit electronic. Grab some Xboxes and TVs, I think about 7. I told them that these are all gifts, so they won't even question. Soon as I got up to the counter, they start asking questions. Like, am I getting these for kids or some family members? I said, cause I ain't get them none for Christmas in December. She responded back like, okay sir, I understand. Had an Xbox in the left and TV in the other hand. Told her I think I lost my cash, let me call my friend. Shit. I let 2 minutes pass by and reach inside my pocket. This one shit about to get real and nobody can stop. Listen, pulled out the debit card. So what you see there in a sense, and I think, as I say, I mean, based on Holly's principle of making artwork about the world as it is currently, I can't think of a better example of that than TJX6, right? Like, you have this guy that ultimately, in a sense, represents an isolated, independent actor in a dystopian United States, right? In a dystopian Detroit, in which he clearly feels that he has to look out for himself and himself alone, and basically releases tutorials on how to scam other poor people. You know, and that's that ought to be no surprise, right? As we see here, I don't know if anyone's had the displeasure of coming across this guy before, but this is a guy called Fuck Jerry, who has an incredibly popular Instagram account. And his Instagram account is basically, he finds memes often by young black clever teenagers that are doing pretty well online. He screen captures them and posts them on his Instagram, and he sells brand placement opportunities, sometimes for, yeah, up to $30,000 per post to be associated with that meme, right? And so in a sense, this kind of punk mentality, this independence mentality of the 20th century, when taken to its logical conclusion, we see that people just fuck each other over, right? That the systematized lying that I was describing earlier is formalized into its own economy. You could also argue the same for someone like a Virgil Abloh. I'm not sure who here might be familiar with him, but Virgil Abloh is a DJ and the creative director of Louis Vuitton, you know, this large colonial French fashion house, who made his name, he's very close with Kanye, and basically made his name making streetwear. He's actually reformed the entire fashion industry to his credit. But his idea, basically, his kind of like undergraduate thesis, is called 3%. And the 3% life, as he describes it, is basically borrowing from the traditions of hip hop sampling culture. I think this is a very, inappropriate usage of that legacy, to basically sample ideas he finds online and alter them 3% so that he can sell t-shirts without paying the people who he's stealing from. And what ends up happening there, I mean, that's kind of an interesting, you know, whatever, like, it's interesting as an art project if you're selling a couple of t-shirts, but what he's done is he's taken this logic of kind of sampling, borrowing from all the goodwill, of course, of 20th century hip hop culture, and he's now doing that for Louis Vuitton, and he's confessing to it. So we now have this colonial powerhouse, major fashion company that makes, you know, in some cases worth billions and billions of dollars, who are openly admitting that they steal from people, and that's how they make a living. You know, so you posting your ideas online, Virgil Abloh sees nothing wrong with the idea of him stealing your idea and using it to sell product for Louis Vuitton. That's new, and I think also kind of qualifies this critique that I have of beautiful ideas of the 20th century, I would argue somewhat naive ideas of sampling and freedom of information, being taken to an extreme and ultimately to an absurd level, that now you have the biggest companies in the world who feel free to take from anybody using the kind of cool associated with, say, hip hop culture. That to me is a problem and kind of a sign that we need to move on. Here, I kind of said this earlier, everybody getting free access to express themselves online is a cool thing. Nobody would deny that. But ultimately what that ends up being is, when you don't have an economic system in the middle, it turns out to be free research and development or for the wealthy, entrenched, and the shameless. And the point is that independence as an ideology is not resilient to this. We don't have an answer to this, right? When you speak to most people from most subcultural backgrounds, the idea, for example, of sampling is a universal good, right? We have no ideology that accounts for the idea that somebody up here can sample from somebody down there. Our only conception is the idea that it's the little guy against the man, right? We don't, and actually the way it's worked out economically is the exact opposite, right? It's the big fish sampling everybody below them. And our ideologies from the 20th century have no answer for that, because sampling, for example, is a universal good because of this accessibility argument, right? So I hope that comes across how that gets really complicated and ultimately kind of untenable. So to describe some of the scams, this will be fun. Streaming scam, I'm gonna run through this because I wanna get to more positive stuff, but you know, streaming scam, you as a musician give your work away for free, Spotify withholds the individual listener data, so they don't tell you who's listening to your work. But what they do is they give you demographic information. So they might tell you that people in Mexico like your work. And then what? That's just enough information for you to spend money, and that this will happen through them in the near term. Just enough information for you to spend money to buy advertisements, so that one day you yourself can create your own ad network. This scam pretty much works the same on Instagram, right? Like, you basically market yourself to enough people so that eventually you can sell, just like Fuck Jerry, you can sell access to people through there. So ultimately the creative economy in this scam is pretty much, it's more to be understood as kind of like a data economy. It's a data hoarding scam economy rather than anything to do with music or whatever. Now similarly, this is where it gets maybe a bit more controversial. In electronic music circles, I would argue that there's a similar logic with DJing, right? So DJing, which now in the 20th century, the DJ economy worked. Now, in the contemporary moment, you have a scenario where you're encouraged to give your work for free because you're told nobody would pay for it, right? So you give your work for free to DJs, you send them promos. People higher up in the food chain will make money from your music, right? So DJs can play your music out. They make a fee from that, and very oftentimes you don't see any of that money. and if you do this well enough of them give you as an electronic musician exposure, so that you too can create your own business, earning money from the free work given to you by smaller producers in the food chain, right? So you kind of see this kind of how this works also with the kind of multi-level marketing scam that streaming has become. I'm going to move on past this. Moving on past all this, because it's kind of fun, but I'm worried we don't have enough time. Yes. And so, and to add the, to make this a little bit more urgent, why we need to consider other systems is that I believe that it's inevitability that streaming will enter the club, right? So when we talk about DJ economies not really having a mechanism to compensate the people who are making the work, and instead all of the benefits are going to the people who can market themselves the best to perform the work or to play the work. The PROs, the publishing rights organizations who used to manage this stuff are incapable. They're not doing a very good job of managing this stuff.
Yes. Interrupt you. Actually, Richie Horton, I'm sure you're aware of this. Like, he had this idea that the mixer, or I don't know, like the players will send the IDs of the tracks being played to the PROs, or like that didn't go anywhere yet, but maybe that will help. I don't know.
It's really, really relevant you bring that up, because actually Richie and I just published a two-part podcast on our Interdependence podcast, discussing this and discussing why that didn't work. And actually, my proposal in this space, which Richie has in some senses adopted, I don't want to pretend that I know whether he's going to fully adopt it in his practice, but he's accepted, is that actually, even if you do track plays, that still goes through the PRO logic of compensation, which is oftentimes like completely skewed. You know, so somebody could be making 100,000 euros headlining a major festival, and you might make 100 euros. My proposal on this is instead to introduce a guild model in which basically a percentage of big earner DJ fees, the fees themselves, are distributed to all of the artists in which they play. And so building off of Richie's experience trying this stuff, he's actually conceded that probably is the best model. Which I think I consider a huge win for the work I've been trying to do. So I think that like music recognition technology, et cetera, putting these boxes in a club to determine what music is played is not necessarily a bad proposal. But if it's going through the old PRO models, there again, it's kind of like the same scenario with Spotify. Their systems are not designed to facilitate the 5 to 10% large minority that I'm discussing, that I think people in the room account for. They, again, are a one-size-fits-all model. And so my proposal in that realm is that if a DJ makes, let's say, more than 5,000 euros per show, a progressive percentage of that fee ought to be distributed between all of the people who are played. And Richie, gracefully, I think, is... And I think, honestly, full respect to him, because he really does not need to be saying that he should be paying people more. But I think that it's actually far more progressive and interdependent a proposal. And of course, it's really complicated and interesting how you would implement that. But I think, honestly, it's more possible to implement that than it is to reform the PROs to represent the minority of 5 to 10% of people. Anyone in PROs I've spoken to about this specific problem has not been able to answer when I ask them, will you solve this problem for my community in my career span? Nobody has said yes. So I think that's a really, really valid thing to raise. But and I'd recommend that you all check out the two-part conversation that Richie, Holly, and I have on this specific topic on our podcast afterwards. But the point being is that we are already demonstrating, in a sense, through this independence economy, that we don't care about where music comes from, and that we don't care about compensating the people who make that thing. And as we were trying to allude to earlier, I can't talk about this too much, but enter AI. If we do not care where this stuff comes from, what these models are trained on, we're fucked. We're in a really, really bad situation. And I want to be kind of catastrophist on that, because genuinely that is very, very bad. So if we're already setting a precedent, AI, like any science fiction story, is really just a reflection on the present day. If in the present day we're saying that we don't really care that people who make the work get paid, then you know, if we're training an AI on our ethics system there, we're fucked. So I'll just leave it at that. yeah, so some ideas just won't die. I think the zombie independence thing needs to die. This, actually, your question preempted this stuff here. This is a cool DJ making a ton of money playing other people's music. And this is basically me describing exactly what I said to you about how you could reform that problem. I won't go over that again. And so ultimately what I would argue is that, to speak to the question earlier of how do you compete with this, you compete with independence by basically determining the value set and determining, like, you know, determining what is missing from those systems that is actually valuable to people in the long term. And here I have, you know, an image of Buffy with interdependent utopian protocol mindset, which is garbled language for saying, like, there is a future, there is a different path for the 21st century that we could all pursue. And I have a few ideas about it. I've no doubt that many of you in the room would have your own ideas about how to implement this. But to speak to the question we had, the question earlier related to Spotify, my gut says that the way in which you compete is to become uncompetitive. The way you compete is not to make Spotify, but with some minor tweaks, it's to do something else entirely. And that, you know, for me at least, is my interest in interdependence, is looking at other economic relationships that we can make with people. So the argument here is interdependence is all the good stuff about independence without the cannibalism, without this idea that everybody below a certain level is basically just stepping over each other to try and get ahead, right? And actually, when you talk to most people in this small minority, 5 to 10%, who music defines their lives, generally when they think about independent music, that's what they think. They think about interdependence. They think about labels and communities of people and club nights and promoters and venues and institutions. They think about all these things that bring meaning to their life. They aren't thinking about dog-eat-dog shit. It just so happens that everybody else is thinking that, right? So maybe one easy claim for the need for interdependence is to distinguish people who care about all those kind of holistic elements from the mercenaries, right? From the sociopathic mercenaries who see independence as basically just me and my iPhone against the world and fuck everybody else, right? Like, so I like the idea of people paying stuff. So some of the principles of interdependence here are like attribution and fair compensation, killing the individualist mythos, this myth that you can do it all by yourself, which is bullshit, equity, which I'll talk about more, spreading wealth internally, which I think the DJ proposal talks about, right? Like, in the DJ proposal I talked about, I want the big DJ, the headline DJ, I want them to make even more money. I want them to take even more money from the brand that helps to fund their headline fee, so that the community of music that they play gets more money as a percentage, right? Spread the wealth internally. Trustless and transparent, I won't go into that too much, but I like the idea of these things being transparent. We'll talk about that a little bit with Web3. And the big, big fundamental point that I hope I managed to communicate or articulate, at least in this session, is tell the truth, right? Because if the independence economy has led us to basically be scamming each other, to deceiving each other, constantly posting pictures with a smile on our fucking face, whatever level of deceit we participate in, interdependence means communicating the truth to people, right? And the truth is not necessarily always nice, but the truth is something you can do something with, right? The truth is something you can build a life around, right? That's one of my biggest, I don't come from a moneyed background, right? Like, I have privileges in my life for sure, but one of the biggest things that annoys me the most is when people talk about the creative economies and they don't tell people the truth, because people invest their youth into this, they invest their careers into this, and I think it's cruel and shameful to sell people pipe dreams. When in actuality, you know, when you tell people the truth, that there's actually a lot more optimistic stuff that can come from it, you know, because there's tons of stuff. And so, actually, this meme, I'm not going to go through all of these different things. But basically, I made a mean to post online to compare the principles of independent music and the principles of interdependent music. So most of the stuff that I've just described is pretty much in this meme. I'm not going to go too much into it, but it's a fun one to keep as or put on your fridge. So one of the things I've been looking at, this is kind of moving into more optimistic realms, is actually looking at the history of guilds. So for those who maybe aren't familiar, a guild is kind of like a union, but it's kind of like a decentralized union. Now, we could have an argument about the definition, but when you think of unions, usually you think of like employees of a certain company or employees of a certain profession that are localized. Guilds, in fact, the history of them is absolutely fucking fascinating. But guilds are basically a means to bring together a decentralized group of people who have shared interests, whether that be through a field or whatever, and allowing them to kind of collectively govern a certain field or collectively bargain on behalf of that group, right? So guild and union distinction isn't huge. There are some, but historically, guilds are kind of interesting because when the first ever guild was something called the Corpora Nabilicorum, which is my bullshit Latin, I don't speak Latin, but it was basically established as a means for independent navigators. So in Rome, basically for independent navigators to be able to communicate with each other to set prices and be able to communicate with the leadership of the city, right? So the idea was you had all these independent people out there who had their own boats and they were doing their own shit. The guild model allowed for them to respect each other's time. What's interesting about certain guild models like this, also the history of insurance was born from a similar principle, right? Of navigators basically saying, huh, like, if we were to collude together, what if I put half of my grain on your boat and you put half of your grain on my boat? So if one of our boats goes down, we only lose half our grain, right? So there's all kind of institutions that were actually built on top of these kind of guild or decentralized kind of collaboration networks. And this becomes really interesting because there's actually a whole bunch of tech, new tech emerging to start implementing some of these things. I'm part of a small kind of research group actually called Guild. You can go to guild.is based on these principles. There's a lot of smart people thinking about this there. Building on this, so thinking about guild models, another area that I'm very interested in that I think speaks a little bit to the COVID situation and a little bit to what you talked about earlier with the grassroots is the question is when we're thinking about protocols, so this idea of implementing an ethical system into a technical system, right? Protocols, the Bible or the Quran is a protocol, right? Marxism or capitalism is a protocol. But you could also say the same for, HTTP, IP, right? Like the protocols that make the web work. How would you synthesize these things in a meaningful way in a palpable way that people could experience? And I think that there's precedent of this when you start looking at the history of clubs. So this is, for example, in 1971, a project by Grupo 9999 and Super Studio, who were designers and architects, called Space Electronic. And basically at the time, there's a great book on this that I can recommend. I forget what it's called, but it's basically like the history of club design. But basically in the 70s, there were all kind of utopian proposals for how we might hang out together. And in fact, the kind of the birth of the modern disco and the modern club correlates quite heavily with some beautiful ideas that were being had at the time. And those of you who may be familiar with Super Studio, many of their designs and kind of architectural thinking also precedes a lot of the web. They imagined a future in which we were all somewhat connected and freely exchanging information. The difference there is that they also had, with this space electronic model and others that they experimented with, they had group spaces that people could come to and convene in. This is one thing that we missed with all the internet, like they anticipated the internet, but their model had clubs that were built around some of these ideas. Like, and this is one thing I'm very, very interested in, is how might we provide more ways to capture some of the utopian potential of the online space and have that better reflected in spaces. And one thing I've been looking at, for example, is this idea of the automat, which I'm not sure if in Czech that translates pretty well, but the automat or automaten is a concept from the 1800s in Germany, where, you know, there were actually very, very different competing visions for what socializing might look like. This is an illustration of Kisisana, which was an automated restaurant. And the idea at the time was that basically you might be able to implement certain technical protocols in a social space. And that, for the time being, for the purposes of time, that's all we really need to know. But I'm very interested in this idea, like how might you be able to integrate certain technical protocols from the internet into real space. This is the Metro, which is actually literally around the corner of me. And they basically worked on it for some time, worked on an equity model. And so they basically created a co-op in which numerous people could own a share in the club. And interestingly enough, they also had a token system. They had their own internal currency for a period of time. And there was similarly a bar in the 2000s in Berlin called Bar Automaten, which is basically a vending machine bar, which for my purposes is actually quite interesting, because when I talk about some of the Web3 stuff that I'll get into, one of the ideas, the fundamental ideas behind Web3 is this idea of smart contracts, right? So this idea that, and the best way to describe a smart contract is that you encode into a piece of software almost like a vending machine logic, right? Now, when you talk about something like a network like Ethereum, which I'm very interested in, you basically have this idea that says, okay, when I buy this digital file from you, the software has a smart contract built into it that says, divide the $10 that I share equally between all the people who contributed to that release, right? So you eliminate a middle entity that might have to do all that bureaucracy, and you just build it in kind of like a vending machine. Now, that's a very simple transaction, but I don't have enough time to talk about the concept behind Ethereum, which is one of the main Web3 protocols. But the basis is, once you start thinking about formalizing economic relationships in code like that, you can build very, very, very complex systems that just work, and they don't need intermediaries to account for them or to profit from them, right? Or to take rent from them. And so I'm quite interested in how this correlates or works with some of the proposals that I'm about to show you. So one thing I'm personally interested in is this idea of interdependent clubs. This speaks a little bit to what I was saying earlier with the proposal with Richie to basically instantly potentially share a percentage of live fees with all the people whose music contributes to an evening. But the idea of interdependence when we think about clubs is fundamentally, number one, they must be internationalist, right? They must be reflective of the diversity of musics and communities in the world, because that's the world I want to live in. That's why I'm in music. I'm in music, sadly, because I want to be there in Prague right now, and I want to be in Budapest, and I want to meet people in China. This is a fundamental aspect of living life in music, is that ultimately I want to participate in an internationalist community. And so interdependent clubs, or thinking of clubs as nodes in a network, is very, very optimistic to me, rather than seeing these things as kind of atomized and individuated. Now, what's kind of cool about that, building on what I was talking about with the Richie DJ proposal, is that those clubs could also, in a sense, work to maintain a network that allowed those kind of payment systems to happen. I won't talk too much about that, but I think there's a lot to be discussed there. I'm also particularly interested in this idea, I've brought it up a bunch of times, in equity, right? So what if, for example, and I always use the example here of ballroom music. For those who aren't familiar, ballroom music is a queer subculture that is based upon a ball, this idea of a dance, right? The music exists in many ways to facilitate a physical thing that happens with a very specific community of people, right? The music isn't immaterial. It sounds good when you're working or whatever, but fundamentally, ballroom music exists for the ball, for dances that happen in real space. And so my provocation here is to say, well, what if, rather than trying to sell individual tracks by ballroom artists, instead we attempted to sell equity to everybody who likes ballroom in a few spaces globally, to ensure the future of ballroom music, to ensure that those rooms exist where that work can be played, and that indeed those spaces might be able to reflect the preferences of the specific community. In this case, ballroom. So I personally think that having an ownership share and supporting the continuation of physical space in this sense is a far, far more powerful and interesting idea with more interesting aesthetic potential than the idea of trying to sell individual tracks on Bandcamp or whatever. Like, who gives a fuck? Similarly, when you start thinking about club networks as being interconnected and international in this way, ideas like telematic performance start becoming interesting, right? And I mentioned this a little bit earlier. First off, it makes no sense, and you've no doubt experienced this. Flying someone from New York to play the same techno records that someone who lives down the street from you was playing doesn't make really ecological sense, and increasingly won't make economic sense when the price of flights goes up ridiculously because of carbon tax, right? Now, also, in COVID, there are all these proposals that are saying the future of what, I don't know how many of you here suffered sitting on Zoom raves or whatever, but clearly the future of clubbing is not sitting on Zoom. If that is the case, then everyone's just going to be playing video games every weekend, which, by the way, is what they do anyway. We're not going to be able to compete with video games for immaterial online experience. Now, what I would propose here is that there are actually possibilities. What would it mean to be able to connect a club space in Prague and a club space in New York? How would that alter, how would that add a dimension to the experience without detracting away from all that we love about club music, i.e. going to a place with your fucking friends and getting to smell them and drink things with them, right? So in a sense, the answer here, or the thing I'm mostly interested in, is in connecting spaces rather than replacing them. And to this point, in terms of this idea of selling equity in spaces, actually, there's a number of proposals that already do this. This is a company called BrickBlock that is, I think, quite evil, but they're basically trying to sell fractional ownership of buildings to, the Chinese middle class in the form of tokens. If you think Airbnb was devastating to cities, can you imagine what a future might look like where, an entire street in the United States or China could own a fractional percentage in a valuable building in Prague and just, use it to earn rent. It's kind of frightening. But those same mechanisms can also be used for somewhat more optimistic ends. So when it comes to clubs in this sense, oh please, does someone have a question?
No, sorry, Matt. I'll just interrupt you for a bit. We can go on, but we actually have a like not really a party, but concert going on in the backyard, which is just behind the wall. And we have to do that because like there's a curfew, so we have to follow the schedule for the outside thing. So we will go on with the lecture, but the party will go on and behind the walls. So maybe you will, they will be, noise here a little bit more than.
No problem at all. And I'll keep this brief and start moving to more examples. Thank you. Thanks for the heads up. And also, by the way, if people.
Just to touch on what you discussed just right now, we are currently having a conversation with the Shape platform, with Matt Schulz and with Alan from Mutec and Samuel from Lessius Electronic, and we are actually like trying to figure out like how to do our business in the coming year, or at least like this year, next year, or maybe the telematic connection, like this is something like Samuel Tash from Les Siest, who is trying to find a solution how for example a band in Paris can play a music of a Taiwanese artist in Paris without the travel and with all the travel restrictions, and also considering the carbon footprint and everything
awesome.
this is something like we're discussing at the moment.
Awesome. And in case anyone's particularly interested in that, I would absolutely recommend Actually, Holly's doctoral thesis advisor at Stanford is a guy called Chris Chafe, and he is probably the world's expert on telematic performance, and he's built a lot of tools to enable people to do that. So I would absolutely recommend looking up Chris Chafe. It's C-H-A-F-E. If that is your interest, he's also a wonderful person who's really excited to talk about this stuff. But that's really encouraging. I also really like the Shape platform, and in a sense, it kind of fulfills, or you know, maybe formally it's structured a bit more different. But this idea of a guild, this idea of, you know, transnational groups of people trying to make shit happen, working together, and yeah, it's a great thing. I want you all to party, because I know we don't have any opportunity to do that anymore. So I'm going to run through it a little bit. Basically, the here with this slide, you know, one wonders when you connect a club to a network in that way, and you start talking about proposals like equity or shared governance, you know, can a club come to own itself with every beer and ticket sold? Can a club compensate artists automatically, as I've proposed with Richie earlier? Can it be governed by international crews of members? You know, what does it mean for people in the Czech Republic to have a governance stake in a club in Berlin? I think this is particularly interesting because, you know, obviously one of the great kind of injustices of the way music works is it tends to be very kind of Anglo-centric, right? And like, as we know, I mean, like, I have a much more kind of, let's say, like, humble appreciation of how much you know, these scenes and contributions in scenes come from all over the place. I think it would be very progressive and interesting to see what might happen for international crews of people to be able to have governance stakes in other places. What might it mean to program a space differently for each usage? Would a club with these kind of protocols outcompete others? To speak to your point earlier with Spotify, you know, I think the equity proposals will outcompete others, at least for the minority that I care about. And what other experiments can we hold in real life to better reflect the visionary proposals occurring online, right? Okay, I'm gonna move past this. And so some of the, some cool examples that I think, historical examples that are maybe worth bringing up, I won't hammer home the importance of George Lewis to Holly and I, or the AACM, or the Art Ensemble of Chicago, because we've talked probably too much about them today. But the AACM, I think, is in a sense kind of a foundational example of like an interdependent organization. I mean, as a jazz ensemble, their whole idea was basically creating a strong group so that individuals might flourish. And many would argue that even the form of certain improvised jazz ensembles kind of demonstrates this in real time. But the AACM, I think, is a really, really remarkable thing, and I can't encourage you enough to pick up this book. It's a beautiful object that exists in the world, and everyone should read it. But building more further, this is something that maybe people here won't be familiar with. In the Ethereum ecosystem, there's something called a DAO, so a decentralized autonomous organization. So when earlier I'm talking about distributing groups to distributing equity to groups of people online who might be in different places, this is kind of what a decentralized autonomous organization is. So the way that Moloch DAO, which is one of the most popular DAOs in the space, works is basically you have a group of different people who invest a small amount of money in order to be a member. And once you are a member, you are able to vote on proposals that come in. And you also hold a piece of equity in the DAO. And what that vote does, for example, I think last year they distributed, I think it was like $600,000 to developers who basically made, any developer in the world can request funds from the Moloch DAO. They send a small proposal, and then a group of people you've never met, and you vote on where that money should go. And so this idea of a DAO or a guild or some kind of collective bargaining system with equity, this is already happening in the Web3 space. And I think and it's becoming easier and easier to create DAOs. I forget, there's a company called DAO Stack. There's a bunch of them now where it's almost an inevitability that in the next couple of years, we're going to begin to see DAO labels, DAO publishers, DAO magazines, et cetera. It's going to be everywhere. But it's really worth checking out Moloch in the short term because it's one of the examples of kind of a robust DAO that kind of that's already doing the business. Similarly, when we start talking about real estate, this is the NEIC, the Northeast Investment Cooperative, based in Minneapolis. And so the idea here is not dissimilar. It's basically kind of like a DAO for a city, thinking about real space. And so the way the NEIC works is they use an investment vehicle called an REIT. Oh, it's funny, I just remembered actually, BrickBlock, who I mentioned earlier, who are the evil company who are trying to do similar things. Their first tokenized real estate that they did was actually in the Czech Republic. A group of thousands of people bought a parking garage in the Czech Republic by just buying digital tokens online. And the NEIC works in a similar principle, however, with more kind of beneficial ends. And so basically what happens with the NEIC is you invest a small amount of money to become a member. And then people come to the group and say, hey, I think that it will be beneficial for everybody if we had a coffee shop downtown. I think it would help the city to grow. I think it would help the city to become more cool or whatever, or more friendly to people. So they petition the NEIC, and then the members will pull together to acquire a space for that business, because they understand that interdependently, maybe that coffee shop will bring more value to everybody. And so I think this is a really cool model, and you can take inspiration from that, even though, you know, we're talking here about real estate and like large expenses, but thinking about small expenses of like smaller, at least, expenses of releasing something or building something. These principles of kind of collective governance and collective equity, I think, are quite easy to see manifest in the world. And also, I want to make clear that, you know, when I talk about some of these interdependent principles, I'm sure everyone here, we probably fall on a political spectrum that leans heavily to the left. Some will be more extreme than others. But when I talk about interdependence, you can cut this in many ways. There are many ways for you to basically put together, you know, non-profit, communist organizations based on these principles of shared equity and shared governance. And you can also think of, you know, maybe more progressive forms of capitalist organizations on this. And I want to qualify this just because when I talk about this, this isn't some like me being like a lefty academic that's disconnected from the real world. There are huge venture capital firms that are starting now based on these principles. And this is one called Variant Fund. We also spoke to Jesse Walden, who founded this fund, and interestingly comes from a music background, used to be Solange and Dev Hynes' manager, and now works in venture capital. But he's basically putting together a huge fund to be able to fund what he calls the ownership economy, this idea that the platforms of the future that we use, each of us will demand an ownership share in those platforms, right? So whether you're doing this from like a very ideological kind of lefty perspective, or you're doing this basically just to want to create competition for someone like a Spotify, these are not granola socks and sandals, small time ideas that I'm describing. These are very, very powerful ideas that are being validated in all corners right now. And then sadly, music always tends to be one of the last ones to realize things. And that's part of the reason why, at least with the podcast that we do, we're trying to talk to many people who are working on the vanguard in this. I might disagree with them in terms of how they want to apply certain things, but the principle remains clear. Thinking interdependently, thinking equitably, thinking about group ownership and focus on the collective over the individual is the new economy. If we are to have a new economy, that is the mode by which it must operate. And simply down to that basic law we were describing earlier, we're not going to be able to outcompete Facebook or Spotify based on their own terms. They're too big. We need a different economic proposal. And so interdependence, whether you're talking about it on a smaller scale, with as I say, nonprofit or let's say ideological aspirations, or whether you're thinking about businesses, this is I believe to be an inevitability and in a sense optimistic in that sense, because we're in a position now where it does feel like certain things might never change. And the good news is I'm not that old, I'm like 35 now, but I've seen things change dramatically in the past. And when I encounter these ideas, I have a very strong sense that the next fundamental shift will be in this direction. And of course, it's far better to be involved in that and be thinking of ways to do that beneficial to you and your community than to simply just observe it from afar. And so before I close for questions, basically, The other thing, not to unduly plug, but Holly and I, over COVID, because we've had more time on our hands, have basically, we started this podcast, Interdependence. You can listen to it for free on interdependence.fm, where we've basically, all these questions around machine learning, group ownership, Web3 protocols, DJ payments with Richie Horton, et cetera. We're basically having long form conversations to go deep on this. And so if you're interested in this stuff, our job is to try and find all these people so that you don't have to, So that's kind of where I'm at. And I'd happily discuss anything with you all in more detail. I hope that wasn't too much of a tsunami of information. And hopefully there's some optimistic stuff that comes from this.